Thanks to you all for being here. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about limit sets of groups, discrete groups. But I'm going to start from the bottom. Today I'm going to focus on the classical setting, which is groups of isometries, of H, hyperbolic n space for n equals 2 and 3. So a lot of what I'm going to say in the first part today has already been said today in the various lectures, so that's very good for me and also for you. So let me begin with a few words about this guy. So yesterday we saw several ways of thinking of the real hyperbolic space. Let me redo it, and you will see that many of yesterday's things will come about. Let me start with H2. Let me consider H2R. And remember, we have the disk model, Poincaré's disk model. Okay, and we have the two-dimensional disk, D2 in R. We can think of it as being. There are many ways of thinking of it. Let me think of it as being the unit disk in R2, which we equip with a special metric, the hyperbolic metric. And in order to do that, I'm going to let me, before giving the metric, I'm going to give you the group of isometries for the metric. So John described it beautifully yesterday using linear algebra in a way which works in all dimensions and for real complex and quaternionic spaces. Let me do it in a geometric way, also using some of the material introduced yesterday in Francois' lecture. Remember, we spoke about the inversions. Okay, so what is inversion in R2? Suppose now this is a sphere of some radius R in R2 with some center at some point P. Okay, so yesterday we defined inversion in Francois' lecture as follows. If you want to know who is the inverse of this point, X, what you do is you take this ray that joins X to the center, and you map this point to the unique point in this line, in this ray, such that this distance times this distance is the radius to the square. There's a unique point like that. Okay? So that is the inversion in the circle in R2 with center at P. And that gives you a map from R2 minus P into R2 minus P, and it can be extended to R2 union infinity by mapping P to infinity and infinity to zero. Okay? Let me recall that R2 also union infinity is nothing but the two-dimensional sphere. And in general, Rn union infinity is Sn. Okay? This we all know, I guess. And if we don't know it, we can prove it with one picture.
Yes.
I'm using this image.
It's a conformal notion.
Yes.
So just using angles, you can define this.
Okay.
You draw this ray, Px. You draw a perpendicular.
Yeah.
Like it cut the circle in 2 points.
Yeah.
Draw the tangents.
Okay.
And point at the section.
Okay.
Yeah.
You use some. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Very good. Okay. Okay, now that way of doing it, and also this way, also is something important, also apply in all dimensions. See? Yeah. Okay, so the same notion applies for whenever you are in Rn, and you can take codimension one spheres, you define inversion in exactly the same way. Okay, that's very important. Now, one very important property of inversions that comes out from yesterday's talk, essentially, is the following. Suppose you have two circles that intersect. Okay? When does the inversion in one leaves the other one invariant? Okay? That's an easy exercise coming from basic properties of inversions, which is the inversion in one of these leaves the other one invariant if and only if they are orthogonal. Okay? And so now let G be group generated by inversions on all circles in R2 union infinity, which is S2. And when I write it like this, I'm including the lines in R2. Okay, those become circles here. Okay, and then the inversion in one line is just the reflection. So let us look at the group generated by all these inversions. Okay, then it's an exercise to show that G acts transitively on the disk, the unit disk. That means if now this is the unit disk in R2, if we take any point and we take the origin, if we take any point, there's one transformation mapping the origin to that point, or taking one point to any other point. The action is transitive. And it's also an exercise to show that the isotropy group is O2.
Restricting the
yes, you're right. Yeah, you're right. You're right. Yeah, I'm taking. Oh, yes, you're right. I forgot. Yes, that's very important. Yeah. Very, very important. Thank you. This is the eraser. It's horrible because it's wet. Every time you use it, you make a mess. But okay. So you are right. Let me denote like G with a hat like that, and then let me denote by G the subgroup of G generated by. Sorry, I messed it up. You're absolutely right. Generated by inversions on circles and lines, orthogonal to the boundary of the unit disk. Okay? Then G acts transitively on the disk with isotropy O2. Okay? And now we can do exactly what Bertrand did, I think, yesterday. We have the disk. We put the usual metric at the tangent space at the origin. And we use the action to spray it around. To define the metric in this tangent space, what you do, you take a transformation taking this point to this one. Being diffeomorphisms, takes the tangent space into the tangent space, and you induce a metric here. Now, if you go there by a different element, if you go there by two ways, then if you take one followed by the inverse of the other, you are in the stabilizer of this point, and the elements preserve the metric. So there's no ambiguity here. It doesn't matter if you go by this transformation or by any other transformation, the induced metric is the same. So you get a metric, and obviously the group acts by isometries with respect to that metric. Okay, that is a hyperbolic metric, and so this is very nice because linear algebra gives us a very tangible way to work with the isometries of hyperbolic space. This gives us a very natural, very tangible way to see what the isometries are. This, every isometry of the hyperbolic disk is generated as a composition of inversions on circles or lines orthogonal to the boundary. It's beautiful. Okay? And that goes through exactly the same proof to all dimensions. If you want to construct hyperbolic tree space, what do? You do the same, but now you consider the spheres of dimension 2 in R3 union infinity. This includes planes. For each such sphere, you have inversion. You look at the group of inversions. You look at those which are inversions with respect to spheres which are orthogonal to the boundary of the unit sphere. Those that generate a group. That group acts transitively on the inside, on the ball, and you give the ball with a metric, and you get the hyperbolic tree space, and so on. Okay? So those are hyperbolic spaces. Very nice. Now, something which comes out beautifully from this description. Which I presume is going to be somehow related to something that John is going to talk tomorrow. You will do it in the complex case. This is in the real case. You said you were going to speak about this, I think. But let's see.
I don't know what you're going to speak about.
No, it's something very nice. Now, look at the following thing. Now, look at hyperbolic tree space, which is the inside of a unit ball in R3. Okay? Now look at the isometries, the group of isometries of this guy. And let me just look at the generators. So the generator is one inversion in one sphere orthogonal to the boundary. Okay? So let me take this sphere. Now, so the inversion on this sphere takes the inside of the ball, which is outside this one here, and this little part here. It leaves the ball invariant, but takes the outside inside and the inside outside. That's the isometry we have of hyperbolic space. But notice that this map naturally extends to a map of the boundary. Okay? When you do that, if you look just at the boundary is a two-sphere. What you have on the sphere is intersection with this sphere, which is a circle. And that circle defines an inversion in S2. And you have a map of S in S2. You have an inversion, okay? And that's a conformal map that it preserves angles, okay? So every isometry of hyperbolic tree space defines a conformal automorphism of the boundary of the two sphere. Which is beautiful. Vice versa. All conformal maps of the two sphere are inversions of circles. Take one of the generators. Say you have this circle on the sphere, and you take the inversion in S2 on that circle. Now, how many spheres you have in tree space which meet the unit sphere orthogonally exactly at this circle? One. You agree? Okay? Very nice. Thank you. Okay? So if you are given a circle in the sphere, there's a unique two sphere in the ambient space which meets the unit sphere orthogonally at the given circle. Now you make inversion in that sphere, and that gives you an isometry of hyperbolic space. which extends to the interior the map you had of the boundary. Okay? So we have proved theorem. Isometries of hyperbolic tree space are the same thing as conformal automorphisms. Here, conformal means preserving angles. I'm not talking about orientations. Often, conformal means preserving orientations. If we want to preserve orientations, then we put a plus here, and we put a plus here. OK? That's very nice. So we already have this. And if you see, we haven't really used that we are in dimension 3. We used it just for making drawings. But exactly the same argument tells you that isometries of hyperbolic n plus 1 space are the conformal automorphisms of the boundary sphere. OK? That's very, very nice. So we have hyperbolic geometry inside the ball, conformal geometry in the boundary sphere. Now let me focus. Yesterday, John mentioned these low dimensional accidents, which are fantastic. And also Bertrand made a dictionary, beautiful dictionary, in dimension, complex dimension 1. So let me now focus on the case n equals 2. So isometries of hyperbolic 3 space. So in that case, we are looking at conformal automorphisms of the two-dimensional sphere. And let me put a plus here. OK? Then we know it's not trivial, but it's elementary from elementary courses in analysis that every conformal automorphism, orientation preserving of the two sphere, satisfies the Cauchy-Riemann equations and is holomorphic. And actually, it's not only holomorphic, but this group is the same as the group of transformations that we saw yesterday, but with complex coefficients. And we can normalize them to have determinant 1. OK? So the Möbius group, or the group of tomographies, is exactly the group of orientation preserving isometries of hyperbolic 3 space. And that's very nice because, you know, hyperbolic 3 space cannot be isometrically embedded in this world. What we can construct the isometries just by looking at things of this form, which is a two-dimensional sphere. And the sphere is just the plane plus one point. So we can make drawings in the plane, and we are defining isometries of hyperbolic 3 space, which is very nice. Okay, and let's see something else. Yesterday we saw that this is the same thing as the group PSL2C. That means 2 by 2 complex matrices with determinant 1. And then we identify those with opposite sign. A, B, C, D is mapped to this. This is easy to see that this is a group homomorphism. And if you go from here to here, it's a group homomorphism with kernel set, the subgroup generated by minus identity. So that's why when you divide by the center, you get an isomorphism. And in fact, this can be seen also very, very nicely in the following way. We know, it was mentioned yesterday, and it's very important, that CP1 is by definition the space of lines in C2. Every line through the origin in C2 minus the origin is identified to one point. Okay? This by definition. C2 minus the origin, and you identify points in the same complex line. And it's clear that, and we know that this is the same thing as S2. Okay? How you prove that is, we'll know it, but let's prove it. We are drawing. I'm going to do it because tomorrow I'm going to use it in one dimension more, the same drawing, but over the quaternions, but the same drawing. So let's see. Put C, let's see, you are in C2. Now, a point here means a line here. I want to see that this is the same thing as S2, which is C union one point. Okay? So we have C here. There are many ways to prove this. Let's do the following. Put here a copy of the complex numbers parallel to this axis. Now, take one line through the origin, which is not this axis. Any line. That line meets this other line, complex line, in exactly one point. So you have a map from CP1 minus one point, corresponding to this line, to C. Vice versa, if you're given any point in this line, there's a unique complex line joining this point to this one. So you're given an inverse map. So there's a bijection between lines here, minus one, with the points here, minus one. Now, when you go to infinity, you add one point, and you're here. Okay, so that gives you the diffeomorphism, actually a biholomorphism between CP1 and the Riemann sphere. And now, if you have a 2x2 complex matrix, that gives you a linear automorphism of C2, okay, in the obvious way. If you have AC and you have a complex number Z1, Z2, that goes to AC1 plus BC2, comma CC1 plus DC2. You have a linear transformation of C2. Now, a linear transformation takes lines into lines. Okay? So it induces a map from CP1 in the space of lines. And which map is that? That is exactly this one, if you think on S2 as being C union infinity. So everything fits together in a very, very nice way. Okay? So, for example, an exercise, beautiful exercise. This is telling us that this group of matrices is exactly the conformal group of S2. In particular, rotations of the two spheres are conformal maps. Okay? Who is the subgroup here that corresponds to these rotations? Okay? Exercise. It's a beautiful thing. Okay. So, well, then we have this beautiful picture. And we can also go one dimension less. We can look at isometries of the real hyperbolic two-space. And this is going to be the group generated by inversions on S1. Okay? In other words, if you have the boundary of hyperbolic, you have D2, now you have the boundary which is S1. You take circles which are orthogonal to the boundary. Okay? Each such circle gives you an isometry of hyperbolic two space. And if you restrict that to the boundary, what you have is on the boundary, you have this interval, and you can define the inversion with respect to this interval that takes this point, the center, to the antipodal point, then this segment to all this, and so on. Okay? So exactly the same picture. So we have this problem, I mean, all these fantastic accidents in low dimension. Now, I next want to look at discrete subgroups of isometries of hyperbolic space for n equals 2, 3, particularly. Just a comment is, well, let's see something. Suppose you have an isometry of hyperbolic 2 space, okay? Then you, so this is hyperbolic 3 space, and here you have hyperbolic 2 space, okay? It's a, there's a natural way to extend every isometry in dimension 2 to an isometry in dimension 3, which is this famous Poincaré's extension. How do you do it? You have a map from, think of our H2 as being this equator plane. Okay? So you have a map that an isometry of this plane. You want to extend it to the ball. How do you do it? Well, suppose this point goes to this point, and so on. Now, you have a point here, and you want to say, who is the image of that point? How do you do it? Well, in hyperbolic 3 space, there's a unique geodesic that passes through this point and is orthogonal to this plane, to the hyperbolic 2 space. Okay? Now, you look at this point. Now, you know that this point goes, say, to this one. Now, through this point, there's a unique geodesic which is orthogonal to the plane. So you draw the geodesic. And then you know that this geodesic is going to go to this geodesic. Now, who is the image of this point? Not the geodesic, but this point. Well, you parameterize this by arc length, and there's a unique point here whose distance to here is exactly the same one you have. Okay? Then you have an extension of the isometry in 2 dimensions to the isometry in 3 dimensions, and you can keep going. Okay? That is telling you that the isometries of 2 space, H2, are embedded in those of H3, H4, blah, 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 in a very natural way. But there's another way to see this. Yesterday we spoke, we saw in the same arguments tell you that isometries, this guy is just exactly the same as the group PSL2R. Okay, these are 2x2 real matrices. Okay? Okay, here you have to take the subgroup of index 2 of an even number of inversions. Yeah. Okay? Now you're okay? Okay. But now the beautiful thing is that no, it's important. Thank you. Yeah. Every such matrix without the P is also a complex matrix. So there's a natural embedding of this group into PSL2C. Okay? That gives you a way of embedding. And we also saw in John's lecture that this is the same as PU11. So this corresponds to different ways of thinking of hyperbolic 2 space. This is for one model, the upper half space model, for the disk model, and so on. Okay, now I want to construct subgroups. Now I want to construct subgroups. First, in H2R, and the sum is here. That means subgroups of PSL2R. How do we do it? Examples we saw in Bertrand's lectures yesterday. One example is this Fuchsian representations of the fundamental group of S compact Riemann surface of genus more than one. Okay? So we have a Riemann surface. We can see that as a quotient of the upper half plane by a discrete group of isometries. And that is giving you automatically a representation of the group inside here. Okay? And then you have naturally a discrete subgroup here. And if you want to go to PSL2C, now you just embed this one in PSL2C, and you have natural groups of isometries, discrete groups of isometries in PSL2C. Okay? Other examples. Let me give one beautiful example, which was also somehow just mentioned by John yesterday, the triangle groups. Take the disk model. And now take a triangle inside bounded by geodesics. Geodesics are segments of circles which are orthogonal to the boundary. Okay? So suppose you have one, another, and upper. And another. It's not very good. It's horrible, but it's. Okay. Let me make it. Suppose you do it like this. Okay? This is a triangle with one vertex at infinity. If you want to make it a little bigger, now we have an actual triangle. Okay? So these are supposed to be segments of circles which are orthogonal to the boundary. Okay? Now each one gives you an inversion. Each one, inversion on each side of the triangle gives you an isometry. Now look, if you make the inversion of this one, the triangle becomes something like this. If you make the inversion in this one, it becomes something like this. The inversion in this one becomes something like this. And then if you keep reflecting, the images of these triangles fill out the space. And if the angles are good, what you get is a discrete group. What means that the angles be good? Well, if you see, when you make the reflection on this geodesic, all this geodesic is invariant. When you make the reflection on this one, all this geodesic is invariant. So if you make the geodesic reflection in one and then in the other, the intersection point is a fixed point. And if you look carefully at the exercise, if you do that, what you end up is by having infinitesimally a rotation around this point by an angle twice this angle. So if this angle is irrational, after you iterate, you come back, but the new triangle will overlap with the other one, and you will keep going there forever, and you are not going to have a discrete group. But if the angle is of the form pi over r, for example, after you iterate, inversion in one and then the other, r times, they are going to come exactly. The triangles are going to fit nicely. And if all angles are like that, you get a tessellation of the disk and you get a discrete group. These are, if the angles are, if you choose the triangle to be of the form pi over r, or pi over q, these are the famous triangle groups, pi, q, okay, so you have this for every angle such that P, Q, R are greater or equal to 2, and 1 over P plus 1 over Q plus 1 over R is more than 1. Whenever you have triples like this, you have a triangle group. You can do the same for quadrangles with some appropriate conditions and so on. So these are, you have many more Fuchsian groups. Fuchsian groups, by discrete definition, are discrete subgroups of PSL2R. Okay. Now let's go one dimension higher. We could keep here for much longer time, but let's have some fun in one more dimension. Now I want isometries of hyperbolic tree space. But since we cannot draw hyperbolic tree space here, let's draw the boundary and let's work on the boundary. Okay? So suppose you have one circle. Inversion here, we know, gives you a conformal automorphism of the two sphere, and that gives you an isometry of hyperbolic tree space. So look, for example, at the group generated by three elements, or by four, if you want, or by R circles, which are all of them pairwise disjoint. Okay? What you get is examples of what are called Schottky groups. Okay? Now, suppose, for instance, you choose your circles in a very appropriate way. For example, perhaps you want to choose it in this way. You start with a unit circle, if you want, and now choose a family of circles which are orthogonal to this, which meet each other tangentially like this, forming a color. In such a way that each of these yellow circles is orthogonal to the unit circle. Now, when you make inversion in each of those yellow circles, that carries the pink circle into itself because they are orthogonal. Okay? So this group, the group generated by inversions in these circles, they all leave this one invariant. Okay? That's a very nice color, beautiful. But now you put it in your bag, you take it for a trip, and when you arrive, it has moved. Okay, it has deformed. So now, yeah. So maybe one of the circles is like this. So now there is not a common circle which is invariant to all of them. Now you make your construction again. And you again have a group of isometries. But something has changed. What has changed? Well, that there is not an invariant circle. Okay. And can we say that in some intrinsic way? Okay. This brings us to the concept I wanted to speak about, which is the limit set. Definition, let G in isometries of hyperbolic N space be a discrete subgroup. By the way, let me just say that discrete subgroups means that it is a subgroup and that as a topological space it is discrete. Okay, because consists of isolated points. So suppose you have a discrete subgroup of isometries of hyperbolic in a space. Then the limit set is the subset of the subset lambda in H N R bar, which means H N R union the sphere at infinity, the boundary sphere of points which are accumulation points of orbits of points. Okay? So you have the ball. You look at one point. And for each element here, you have a transformation of the hyperbolic space union the boundary into itself. So you apply the element. And this point goes to some other point, then to some other point, then to some other point, then to some other point. Let me assume this has infinite cardinality. If it is a finer group, then the orbits have finitely many points, and they don't accumulate anywhere. Suppose the group is infinite. Okay? Then, for each point, you have the orbit. Now, when you look at this, this is a compact space. Every sequence in a compact space has convergent subsequences. So you have accumulation points of the orbits. You look at those for all orbits, and what you get is, by definition, the limit set. Okay. So let's go back to see what happens here. Okay. When we had our original color and we made inversions, the pink yellow is invariant. The pink circle is invariant. Okay? So if we have one point here and we make the inversion, it will come to another point here, here. So orbits in the pink circle will always remain in the pink circle. It's an invariant set. Okay? Now, it's not trivial, but I think we will be convinced easily that if you pick your preferred point in the circle, any one you want, this one. Now take any point outside, this one. Then we can find a sequence of inversions in these circles that takes this one as close as we want to this one. Okay? We first make an inversion in this one, in the circle, so the outside comes inside, this will come to some point here. Then we go to, and then you keep iterating, and you will get closer and closer and closer to every point. So what I'm saying is that the pink circle is the set of accumulation points of every orbit in the sphere. Okay? Now, what happens if you perturb this slightly? So if you have the notes, there's an example in page, let me see. Well, in page 15, you will see something like this with the quality, with the circles in the right place, orthogonal to the boundary. And then in page 16, you will see examples of what is happening. So in those examples, if you have something like this, that the circles are touching each other tangentially, but they have no longer a common orthogonal circle, what is happening is that the limit set is going to be something homeomorphic to S1, but with infinite length, what is called a quasi-circle, which is quasi-homeomorphic to a circle. But no, it's no longer a round circle. Okay. So these are beautiful examples. We could, go the other way around and spread the circles, separating them slightly so that they don't touch each other. Then the limit set becomes a Cantor set. And then, well, you have a fascinating geometry and dynamics involved here. And in this case, no. If you separate the circles slightly so that they don't touch each other, then yes. Yeah.
So you draw a picture.
You want me to make one now? No? No. Yeah. In the whole circle. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so let me give a couple of definitions which are useful. Definition. A discrete subgroup of isometries of is function if its limit set is contained in a circle, in a geometric circle, in a round circle of maximal length in the two sphere. Okay? It is a skew group, let me say G. G is quasi function if its limit set is contained in a quasi circle. That means a closed curve, which is quasi homeomorphic to a circle. If you don't know what this means, just keep it in memory and you will know. I will not enter into that because I'm not going to use it. Okay? So it's somehow bounded distortion from being a real circle. So these are two interesting concepts. And then nowadays, there is a discrete subgroup of isometries of H3R is called a Kleinian group. So Kleinian groups are by definition discrete subgroups of isometries of hyperbolic space. But formerly, the term Kleinian was reserved to a special type, very general, but a special type of Kleinian groups, of discrete groups. Those which whose limit set was not the whole two sphere. Okay? Well, okay, well, no. Let's say some other examples. So we know that consider G in H3R. Okay. So we know that we can. We can represent this by a Möbius. Yes, isometry preserving orientation of a. Yeah, sorry, thank you. Okay, we know we can represent this by a Möbius transformation. AC plus B. Or C plus D. Okay, with complex numbers and determinant and one. And we know that every such map is conjugate to one of the form. Set goes to either set plus one or to lambda set with lambda a non-zero complex number. It's an elementary exercise. Every Möbius transformation is conjugate to one of this type. Okay. In the first case, we have a translation and G is parabolic. Otherwise, G is elliptic if lambda has norm 1, or loxodromic if lambda has norm different to 1. So this classification was mentioned yesterday, but just looking at the cases where the coefficients were real numbers. So the term loxodromic was not mentioned. They were called hyperbolic. So hyperbolic is a special case of loxodromic. So what is the geometry of those maps? If we look at the sphere, this is just a translation, OK? So if we look at the sphere, we have one fixed point, which is infinite, and then all orbits move around things like this. Okay? In other words, if we have the plane and we are translating in that direction, all these lines are invariant. And when we compactify the plane to be the sphere, these lines become circles like this, okay? So that is the first case. The other two cases are, let's see. In the other two cases, when we have this, we have two fixed points, infinite and zero, the origin. Those are two fixed points, okay? Now, if the norm is one, what we are having is a rotation. If the rotation is by a rational angle, after finitely many times, we come back to the identity. So the orbits are finite, and there's no dynamics, there's no limit set. In the other case, each orbit is infinite, but the whole sphere is a set of accumulation points, and actually, when we look inside, I mean, in the other case, we don't have a discrete group. Okay? So if we have an irrational rotation, the corresponding group obtained by all the iterations is not a discrete group. It's not a discrete representation of the integers, so to say. Okay? What about limit sets? Well, if we look at what is happening in hyperbolic space, so this is the boundary. We have S2, and we have hyperbolic 3 space. So in this case, in the parabolic case, we have one fixed point at the boundary, and then we have all the orospheres, and the points move around these horospheres, okay? In the other case, it's very interesting. We have two fixed points. We have one geodesic, which is this one in this case. And then the orbits, along this geodesic, we have something like a translation. And then all the other orbits move from one to the other, spiraling away. When we come to the boundary, what you have is, depending if the norm is greater than 1 or smaller than 1, then the origin is repellent and the infinite is attractive, or vice versa. Okay? And then in that case, the limit set consists of just these two points. Orbits accumulate in the future to one and in the past to the other. Sorry? I have no idea. The etymology.
The story that I heard was that in ancient Greece, that horse races were on a spiral track. And that was called a loxodon. That's the story I heard.
Now, some basic properties. So, in these examples I gave now of cyclic groups, the limit set for parabolic elements, the limit set was consisted of 1 point. For loxodromic elements, it consisted of 2 points. Okay? So, basic properties. One, if lambda, the limit set, has finite cardinality, then it consists of 1 or 2 points. If it has more than 2 points, it has infinitely many points. I'm assuming the group is infinite. Well, OK. Or the group is finite. OK? Two. Well, let me say definition. The group is elementary if lambda has finite cardinality. If it is not elementary, it's called non-elementary, okay? If G is non-elementary, then lambda is the set of accumulation points of every orbit. So we don't need to look at all orbits. It's just any orbit accumulates at the same set. And the action on lambda, so lambda is an invariant set, and the action is minimum. That means there is not a closed invariant subset contained inside it, which is a proper subset. Or equivalently, i.e., every orbit in lambda is dense. Let me give you no more properties, but let me give you a quasi-proof of this. Okay? Let's see. Suppose it's say dimension 2, to make this drawing. Suppose this point x is in the limit set here. Okay? That means, i.e., there exists some y in the disk, let me say here, and a sequence gn of elements in the group such that gn of x, sorry, gn of y, the sequence of points accumulates to x. Okay? by definition. If this point is in the limit set, it means that there is some point here and a sequence of points in the elements in the group that make this one converge here. Okay? So my claim is that if you take some other point, any other point, there is a sequence taking this one, making this one accumulate here. Okay, that is the claim. Let's see. Let me call this one Y. Sorry? Yes, 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 yeah, exactly. Now, look at the distance between these two points. Now, look at the first iterate. You're moving by isometry, so the distance is the same. Next iterate, the distance is the same. Next iterate, the distance is the same. You're always moving, keeping the hyperbolic distance fixed. Okay? Well, now, this point, something I didn't mention, and one more property. So, property zero. The limit set is necessarily contained in the boundary. Okay? The idea is that this happens because inside you're moving by isometries. So the only way, if the group is discrete, the only way how orbits can accumulate is when they go to infinity. Okay? You have to do a little more. That's more basically the idea. So the limit set is contained in the boundary. So this point is in the boundary. And then these two are moving by a sequence of points, and the hyperbolic distance is fixed as you approach the boundary. That can only happen if the Euclidean distance tends to zero. Okay? So these two sequences converge to the same point. That's almost a proof. Because, for example, what if your group is generated by a loxodromic element? And then you have, this is one of the limit points, and you have another one here. And this one never moves. So the argument fails. You agree? So you have to prove that if the group is non-elementary, there are elements in the group that move all points in the boundary. Every point in the boundary gets moved. Okay? Well, then that's essentially the idea for proving this. Three. Look at the complement. Set omega, by definition, equals the complement in the boundary sphere, S2 minus the limit set. Okay? So inside the ball, we are acting by isometries, and the group acts properly discontinuously. Like we heard the definition yesterday, the usual, the definition Todd gave us yesterday a characterization. The group acts properly discontinuously. Suppose the action is free. The action is properly discontinuous if the quotient is a manifold. Definition in general is that the action is properly discontinuously if whenever you have a compact set and you look at the orbit of that compact set, that intersects itself at most finitely many times. Okay? It's equivalent. Now, inside the ball, the action is properly discontinuous. But when you go to the boundary, you don't know. For example, going one dimension less, if the action is free, then it's a manifold. Yeah. In general, it's a manifold. Yeah. Now, take a circle and take a. My goodness. Okay? Take one of these examples I gave before, the triangle group. Then, when you look at the iterations at this group, the limit set is the whole circle. So, the action, so the limit set is the whole circle. However, if you take Well, if you take a virtual triangle, like the case of the modular group, well, it's not like this, but it's not, it's, sorry. If you take a virtual circle, again, the limit set is the whole S1. But what if you, remember this corresponds to circles in the ambient space, which meet the boundary orthogonally. But what if you split your circles a little more? So you have the unit circle, and now your triangle becomes something like this. Then when you look at the action in the boundary, all of this will be outside the limit set. Okay? And all the orbits of these intervals will be in the limit set, will be in the complement of the limit set. In that case, the limit set will be a contour set contained in the circle. Okay? So in that set, so this is the set I'm looking at, the complement of the limit set in the boundary. Here's in one dimension more. So this is the same picture. So this is what is called is by definition. Well, this is the region of discontinuity. And it has several remarkable properties. This is the largest set where the action is properly discontinuous. Okay, so if you have any set in the sphere where the action is properly discontinuous, that is contained inside here. And this is also the region of equicontinuity. Okay, of the group. What does that mean? It's a concept which is very useful. It's very important in analysis. It's very, very useful. Basically, it means that, if you have one map, continuous means that at continuous at one point means that whenever you have epsilon greater than zero, there is X delta greater than zero, such that blah, blah, blah. Okay? When you have a family of maps, equicontinuity means that whenever you have epsilon greater than zero, you have delta greater than zero that works for all elements in the family. Okay? And it's an important concept. Okay, and these are some, there are many, 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 many more very important properties. These are some properties I want to mention. I will stop here.
How many components does it have?
Yes, it can be empty. The limit set, if the group is not finite, then the limit set cannot be empty. But this one can be empty. Okay. Yeah, probably. Omega can be empty. So, for example, if you take any compact hyperbolic three manifold and you take the fundamental group, then the limit set, this region is empty. And there are many more examples. Or it can have one or two connected components, or else it has infinitely many components. So if if this region of discontinuity has more than two components, it has infinitely many components. So, sorry?
Which infinity?
I don't know, countably or uncountably, I better don't say because I will be inventing. I don't know. The limit set is a perfect set. The limit set is a perfect set. Sorry?
Do you have this continuity in the open?
Yes.
Then I think the components should be counter.
I would believe it is so, but I would believe.
Components of omega is counter, yes.
Yeah, I should think so.
But components of lambda.
Ah, no. The components of the limit set. Well, if it's a counter set, yeah.
Yeah, so it can be uncountable.
Yeah. Now, still there's a beautiful, very, 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 very deep theorem. Suppose that the group is finitely presented. Okay? Look at the region of discontinuity and look at the quotient. So you identify points in the same orbit. Then you get a Riemann surface of finite type. Finite that means finitely many components, and each component either is compact or compact minus finitely many points. Okay, that's a deep theorem of Denis Sullivan, Sullivan's finiteness theorem. Alfors. I got confused. Yeah, Sullivan made the interpretation for rational maps, and that's his finite, his non-wandering domains theorem. Sorry. Okay, well, I will stop here today, and then tomorrow I will start speaking about higher dimensions, and that's it.